Thank you very much. So 50 minutes will be fine. So I have a very simple rule there, actually. I can talk for hours, you know, so and just say stop, and then I will stop, you know, so also... And 50, no, exactly. Okay, I have 14 slides, so... good. Welcome back after lunch. It's a great pleasure to be here and a great honor to be here, actually. I'm a big fan of India, so... I'm very pleased to be here and to go on into the exchange, the energy exchange between Germany and India. My name is Gerd Brunekreft. I'm from Jacobs University in Bremen in Germany. There we are. One slide to introduce myself very briefly. I'm an energy economist. Okay, and I should perhaps say, so far at this conference, although I enjoy it very much, I must say, I feel a bit like a strange duck. I hear many technical things I hardly understand, to be honest, you know, so, and now my task is to say something about economics of smart grids or economics of the energy transition. I listed a couple of topics I, together with colleagues in our group, do, and one of the things I'm going to talk about today would be under the header of the governance system of smart grids. Okay, yesterday in a presentation we heard this three layers I found very good. This was by Mr. Simon Müller, I think he pointed this out. First the technical layer, then the economics on top of that, and then moving from economics into the governance structure. Now we're going to talk about the governance structure, especially, and we heard about this yesterday as well, that the buzzword at the moment is flexibility, and that is also the topic of my talk today. How are we going to, or what effect does flexibility have on the governance structures of the distribution networks? It's a big discussion going on in Europe at the moment. It's just starting. We don't know where this is going to end or head for, but we do know in which direction it's going. To give it away in one sentence, what I'm going to talk about is that in 2007, 8, 9, so 10 years ago, meanwhile, we had this big debate on network unbundling. And all of the things which were happening at that moment in network unbundling were actually concerning the transmission networks, gas and electricity. This has all been implemented. Still change is going on, yes, okay, but by and large, this discussion is closed. But due to flexibility triggered by the energy transition, due to flexibility, we see now that this precise discussion on network unbundling to promote competition now shifts to the distribution network, and the distribution companies, for example in Germany, where I come from, are now kind of wondering how the future will like. Okay, so the future role of the DSOs is one of the buzzwords people hear about, and it seems now that the discussion on network unbundling is also picked up for the electricity distribution networks. We work on this in a project for a DSO at the moment, and going to give you some thoughts on this. two remarks, perhaps, before I continue. The physics of electricity supply is always the same wherever you are on the world, if you like. Okay, this is not the case if we talk about governance and institutions. So the rules and regulations of things differ very strongly depending on the country you are in. So you might find that what I'm presenting now is a bit of a, well, strong actually, of a European perspective. That may also be the case for some of the terms. I have learned that, for example, a word like network unbundling is not always used in other parts of the world. Okay, so bear with me, I have a European view at the moment. Second thing is, I noticed these last 2 days, indeed, there is a lot of talk about flexibility, and if you hear five people talk about flexibility, you hear five different definitions. So it seems to me that there is no agreement at the moment what flexibility precisely is. For me, flexibility is the very short-term use of supply and demand response and storage to especially stabilize your network or balance your accounts if you're a balancing responsible party. But important for me, in the new discussion, this is on the distribution network. All these things we already have in and at the transmission level, but the new thing which is happening at the moment, at least for me, is on the distribution network. So If I am talking now about flexibility, I actually mean everything connected to the distribution network and used there. Okay, so second point. Later we can see where this definition is going for. Good. Very briefly, the unbundling in the EU directives. An overview here, I can hope you can read this, it's pretty small, I guess. We are at the third energy directive in Europe at the moment. This is implemented in all member states. At the moment, the member states can choose between three options, which are listed on the right side. Ownership unbundling, a deep ISO, and the independent transmission operator. Okay, all member states have chosen something. I will come to that in a minute, what this precisely is. First thing to notice, these options here, they apply only to the transmission networks. The distribution networks were not much of an option or not much of a topic in the discussion in 2007 leading up to the directive of 2009. The state of the art, legally speaking, for the distribution networks is as the text is in the second directive in the middle. So all, with exceptions by the way, all distribution networks are required to have legal unbundling. And the text of this was first mentioned in the second directive in 2003, going on then was copied into the directive of 2009. So that is the state at the moment. And the point is we're shifting into this discussion whether the right-hand side there, these three options for the transmission networks would now also be models, possibly, for the distribution networks, possibly including ownership unbundling, network unbundling. It's open, we don't know. Actually, it's unlikely that any of these models is going to be the case. It's far more likely that we will find there will be hybrid models, new models, golden middle, if you like. Good. These three models then, very briefly also, with an eye on the time. Ownership unbundling, there you have a split between the network, in this case the transmission network, including the system operator, and the commercial activities, especially the generation power plants, the gencos. This is a split in ownership. So if you own a network, you are not allowed to own shares in power plants, and the other way around. If you already had a vertically integrated utility, you were forced to sell bits and pieces. You had to sell the network. So that is what ownership unbundling is. It's a very tough and strict form of unbundling, the most extreme form. It will do the job, but you will also lose, say, the benefits of coordination if it's integrated. Then in the middle, we have the ITO, the independent transmission owner, which is a strong form, a very strong form, I should say, of legal unbundling. So the utilities are still integrated in ownership. They can do anything they like. They can own anything they like. They can be active in networks, and they can be active in commercial activities and parts. But there's a set of rules which they should follow, which in total then means that there is a very strong form of legal unbundling. You want to separate the activities of the network and the people from the network and the information from the network and the incentives from the network. You want to isolate all this and get it out of the commercial activities in order to promote competition in the commercial activities, in order to avoid a transfer of market power from the network, which is a monopoly, to the competitive stages. So the ITO is a very strong form of legal unbundling, may thus also be a model for the distribution companies where at this moment legal unbundling applies. The European Commission always favored ownership unbundling, but politically was not strong enough to go this way and had to settle for, among other things, the ITO model. And recently, this was in 2014, the European Commission actually made a statement that they now think that the ITO model actually works. It does the job. It promotes and secures competition. Statement, quote, by the European Commission. That might be also a strong indication that the Commission might be starting to think about an ITO approach for the distribution companies if we move into this direction. Thirdly then, and I'm going to go into that in more detail if time permits, the ISO model, which we see here. Now, what happens in the ISO model, some of you may know this very well, these things happen and exist in the US. the utility keeps the assets of the network in the integrated company and is also active and owner of the commercial activities like in power plants, generation, retail and trade. Okay, so that might be in one company. You can be owner of both parts, the competitive parts and the monopoly part. But everything you do with the network, system operation, is taken out and is brought into an independent entity. In all, we call this an independent system operator. So the company, the utility, will own the assets of the network. It will make the investments, but cannot decide what to do with this. Importantly, the company utility decides on investments in the network, not the ISO, unless you have a deep ISO, which is a variation of the same model. Good. Speeding up a bit. Now on to what does this all mean for the distribution networks and where does it come from? What are the drivers? Very briefly, this is a big debate already. You could talk for hours on this, and I have only 10 minutes left or so, or 5 minutes, so I have to be very fast. There are three, say, customer groups for flexibility at the distribution level, okay? We would be talking about the BRPs, that is the balancing responsible parties. I'm not going to step into this, but these are big users. The DSOs, so the distribution system operators, they need flexibility to stabilize their network and to resolve congestion in their network. And the TSOs also now go on to the distribution level to find and use distributed flexibility to solve their problems on the transmission network, okay? So this is important, and this is key of the debate which is taking place. The TSOs now go into very deeply into the distribution networks to rely on distributed flexibility to resolve their problems in the transmission networks. And the distribution companies now sit there and wonder, hang on, what is going on? This is our network, this is our responsibility, so why are they coming into our network? We want to do that. And they try to push back the influence of the TSO. Okay, and this is a big discussion now, and it's called the TSO-DSO interface, or the DSO-TSO coordination problem. Where should the borderline be? Who's responsible for what? This also touches upon a discussion of the future role of the DSOs. The DSOs are actually quite afraid that in future they have nothing else to do but building the network and polishing the lines, and that's basically it, because everything else is then taken over by the TSO. So the fear, and so a big discussion is going on, how are we going to deal with this? Very briefly, immediately going to your right-hand side, I already pointed this out, the TSO and the DSO now simultaneously both rely on distributed flexibility, sources, supply, demand response, storage, if there is, at the distribution network. And what may happen now, or what actually is happening now, is that if one network, say the TSO level, starts to pick up flexible or distributed flexibility, it may actually thereby increase the problems at the distribution network, and the other way around. If the distribution system operator uses flexibility, it may increase the technical problem, congestion problems, at the TSO level. And this problem should be coordinated. How does this work? You know, so who gets priority? Who gets to go first? We would call this the TSO-DSO coordination problem. People are working a lot on this, and the point to coordinate all this might first be we have a set of rules that determine who gets to go first, who gets priority. That might be the TSO, it might be the DSO. More elegantly would be, we install marketplaces. We install a market where both these parties, or all parties actually, simultaneously bid for the available flexibility, distributed flexibility, and then this market, the auction process, if you like, should actually solve this coordination problem between the TSO and the DSO. Problem so far is we don't have a clue how to do this. So this is all in the process. We don't know how it's going to work. We don't know where these markets should be. Should there be several of these markets or only one? How should it look like? Who is going to do this? We don't actually know. It's all in the process at the moment. Secondly then, as the commercial value of the market, the commercial market, at the distribution level is now increasing very rapidly. Solar power, wind power, demand response, and whatever is there. Formerly it was all somewhere else, but now it's shifting. The commercial value is shifting to the distribution level. We also start to think very strongly about creating level playing fields to make sure that all parties there actually have the same chances in the competition they're entering in. Okay? So that concerns then the last point here, the future role of the DSO. Okay? And thereby we enter into this discussion of network unbundling. Is legal unbundling, which it is now, sufficiently strong to guarantee a level playing field in the competitive stages around the distribution network? That is what the discussion is. How much time do I have left? 2 minutes. Okay, thank you very much. So I have to skip a bit. Here is the value chain. I have to kind of, I don't know, shorten this to a quintessential point. There is the value chain of the distribution sector. Say only a couple of years ago, we would think in a value chain in two bits only. There's a monopoly network and there are commercial stages on the other hand, okay? Meanwhile, we have differentiated this picture and we see, especially in the network, that there are different steps in this value chain, which you can consider separately. We see at the top asset ownership, beneath that system operation, then data management, very, very important in smart grids with smart data, data management, then flexibility management, and then lower flexibility market facilitator. Importantly, without going into much detail, actually, rather than thinking in terms of ownership unbundling, here is your network and here are the commercial activities, you might want to think in terms of unbundling where you play around with these different steps, with these different stages in the value chain. For example, rather than splitting off the network, you might want to split off data management alone and leave everything else in the network in the integrated company. Or you might want to think about doing something with system operation. So differentiated steps now to do something with unbundling, so a more differentiated view overall. Let me see, there are three potential sources of third-party discrimination, as this is called. System operation, then a phenomenon which is called strategic investment withholding. Unfortunately, I don't have time to get into this, but that is the key of one of the models. And then information advantage. And if you start to think about unbundling requirements, unbundling measures to secure competition, I would find you have to make sure that all these three sources of potential discrimination have to be resolved, have to be addressed by your measure of unbundling. It's very difficult to get everything right, actually. All the models seem to have their disadvantages. Good. As mentioned, the current state is legal unbundling. Here is the text from the Directive 2009 concerning the distribution companies. What are the options on the table at the moment in the discussion? Well, first, as always, business as usual. Just ignore the problem and see what happens when we hit the wall. Then secondly, I would say an ITO approach, the independent transmission owner. Then it would be an IDO approach, actually, the independent distribution owner. Plus what I would call a common flexibility platform, that the flexibility platform, the marketplaces, are done, executed, operated collectively by the different network companies, not one alone. Then an IDSO, and lastly then ownership unbundling, and actually there are more models, but I didn't list them here. So we're creatively thinking about what can be done here. I wanted to step a bit in IDSO, with an eye on the time, I'm going to cut this very, very short. An IDSO stands for Independent Distribution System Operator. I just mentioned that we have the ISO model at the moment at transmission level, the Independent System Operator. This is an operation implemented in several regions in the US. It is hardly implemented in Europe. It could be done legally by the directive, but people don't do it, or the member states didn't choose it. The same principles now start to apply or could be applied to the distribution level, and then we would call this an independent distribution system operator. I know of two cases in the US where people are thinking about this. One would be in California, and I think the other one is in New York, that people are designing this. If you're interested in these things, these would be the places to look at, because they're actually doing it now. We don't know what is going to happen, how it's going to work out, and what is going to be implemented or not. But so there are real cases at the moment on doing this. Very short, and then I will stop. What is the IDSO model then? Again, the value chain, and you see bits and pieces taken out of the network. But in the utility side, on the left-hand side of the picture, you see on top asset ownership. So the ownership of the lines of the distribution network stay within the vertically integrated utility. So the utilities don't have to sell anything, you know, so they can be owner of assets of the lines and at the same time owner of the assets of power plants and whatever assets. Okay, so this remains to be integrated. But they should then should do away, give away everything which concerns what you do with the assets, with your network, system operation, if you like. I've listed these bits then in the block IDSO, system operation, data management, flexibility management, and then flexibility market facilitator. The IDSO could be market facilitator, but need not be. Anybody could actually be market facilitator, but the IDSO could also do this. The point is that the integrated utility cannot be market facilitator, okay? Because this would then give discriminatory potential. There is a detail problem with an IDSO, and also one can solve this this problem actually for the distribution companies, for the IDSO concept, but with an eye on the time, I'm going to skip this this detail. And with this, I'm going to close off, and thank you very much. Good.